This is a problem. I do not understand. Oh, hello OBS. Yep, Alex, can you hear me? Why is that there? That shouldn't be there. Okay, yes, Alex, can you hear me? Loud and clear? Cool. Thank you, Liam. Thank you, Alex. Hi, Liam, by the way. All right, the old stream, I don't know. Shit the bed and is dead. So I'm going to send this new link out to everybody. Okay. Share, copy, close. I'm going to go. I have to send those two emails again. Close that. Close that. Out of curiosity, of the 39 people in this stream, hello, welcome. I am fighting my streaming service pretty hard right now. Are any of you current ENGG1500 students for 2024, or are you all my old sub crew coming back to relive the memories? Sorry, I'm doing three things at once here, by the way. Just bear with me for like 5 minutes while I sort this out. This is one of the reasons we do week zero streams. So you know what's going on, and also so I know what's going on. Old stream died. Here is the new link. Some newbies? Hey, excellent. I'm guessing then that you guys are all my new sub crew. Appreciate it. Yeah, Alex, can you firefight for me, man? Really nice if I could send Canvas announcements emails, but anyway. I can grab that, and 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 then that, that, that. That, and that. And everybody should now have the new stream link. Okay. Hopefully this works. Let's pop the chat out so that I can actually see what's going on. Hey, Liam. Yeah, I know, mate. Liam is one of my old students. I know that for a fact. Okay, sorry. I'm going to scroll back to the top of the chat and check in. Hey, Begsy. New. Cool. Isaac. Cool. All right. Everybody letting me know they're new. Ian, pardon my old sub crew. Sick. All right. Cool beans. Did I get good by... F hey, it's only 5 past. All right, so sorry for the false start. This was bound to happen. That's one of the reasons we do a week zero stream. It's to sort all of this crap out on my end and sort all of this crap out on your end, such that once things start to get stressful next week, we're doing okay. And overwhelmingly, I guess the thing that I want to give you all the impression of is there's a lot of stuff that's gonna happen over the next couple of weeks, and it's not all gonna go swimmingly. Exhibit A, this has not gone swimmingly, and that's okay. So what we do, and what I do for you in this course is I prep you for all as much of this crap as I can before we get started, so that once we get started, things can run as smoothly as possible. We want your university's career experience that is starting now to be as good, as profitable, as pleasurable, if I can use that word, as humanly possible. And I'm going to do everything I can to help make that a reality. Okay, so you're going to love this. You are. You can see some of even my old students and Alex's old students in the chat here who will come back just to be like, hey, this is great. You're going to really enjoy uni. And I know some of you are probably sitting there going like, well, yeah, that's what I signed up for. And others are probably a little bit stressed right now and a little bit apprehensive and a little bit don't know about starting this whole university business. Trust me, you're going to love it. We're going to make sure of that fact. To tell you a little bit about what we're going on, I guess I've already prefaced this. It's to kind of sort some of the BS is what our objective is today. And over the next 12 weeks, this is what we're going to be able to do every Thursday. You're going to get a little bit of my time in a stream every Thursday, such that we can kind of sit down, chill out, work through some things, recap some content if we need to. But realistically, the objective is to make sure that you are all in a position where you can be as successful as possible, because that's what I want for my students. So that's kind of what we're going to do today. What I normally like to do in the 10 minutes before the stream starts is say, hey, does anybody have any early questions they want to get off their chest right now? Anything they're confused about or something like that? And we normally do a bit of really informal question and answer at the start. If anybody does have any burning questions, please chuck them in the chat. As you can probably tell, I like talking to my chat. I really enjoy it. Talking to my own monitor for time isn't as enjoyable as talking to you guys in chat. So please, by all means, chuck stuff in the chat. Talk to me so that I can actually make sure that I'm telling you things that are useful to you wherever possible. Where do I find the T01/XX? Great question. So where do you find your tutorial number? There's a few different places to find this. Now, the reason tutorial numbers are important is because there are 32 classes running simultaneously in ENGG1500, and I don't know where any of you guys are, so I will often ask you for, I'll call it your tutorial number. There's a few ways to get it. Your MyHub app and your timetable should have it in there. They might call it an activity number instead of a tutorial number, but it should be in there. Another place it's going to be as of next week is in your Discord. Next week in Discord, you are all going to get your own work or tutorial channel for just your tutorial, and it'll be in the title there. So that's by far the easiest place to find it. There's a few other places, and I might show you some of them as well. But Yeah, Discord is the one that most people find it easiest. Do you know the best way to get help from Discord? Speaking of Discord, my account has been disabled because I thought it was a spam bot signing in. This happens to a couple of people every year. I don't know why a few people get singled out. But some people get singled out and considered spam bots. It happens. The hack is to just make a new account. But yeah, you can try and reach out to them. I might ask a few of my people that for you. That is another thing that I will do in these streams, is make myself a little to-do list so that I can make sure I don't miss any of this stuff. I need to do help from Discord for students who are spam bots. I can do that for you. Other than Liam corrupting my chat, which chat, Discord or YouTube chat? If I'm on YouTube, use the YouTube chat. How do you join Discord? I'll show you how to do that in a second. I've got a slide on Discord coming, so we'll get to that. Cool. All right, so let's plow through a little bit of the admin. I try and answer your questions, but I also try and premeditate your questions because I know the kind of standard things that students struggle with at this stage. So, structure is one that a lot of people are confused about at this point, and rightfully so. The way that ENGG1500 will work is each week, you'll get kind of what you got this week if you've seen it. Some pre-recorded content and a live stream for you to talk to me in. So the same deal, videos that I've made pre-recorded that you just sit and watch in your own time, hopefully at a time that's like nice and convenient to you because you can watch them whenever. And then you come to the live stream in this session, you get help. And in between, it's not always in between, it depends on the timetable, but at some stage each week you go to your tutorial. The tutorials are the good bit of this course. In this course, in your tutorial, you're going to build some shit. You're going to do some real world engineering where you actually make a thing. All of the stuff I give you is kind of auxiliary, tertiary, hopefully helpful stuff. But the thing that makes and breaks this course is you're going to get into a classroom, a workshop often, and physically build something that solves a problem and get to experience what it's like to be an engineer. So going to your tutorials is like the key concept of this course. And then to support that, you'll get pre-recorded lectures every week and a live stream with me that you can hang out and get help and stuff like that as much as you need it. We got a couple people who got reported as spam bots. That happens. I will do what I can for you guys. All right, when you need help from me, so something you may not have quite realized yet, as of right now, there is over 620 students in the course. That's probably the biggest class you've ever been in your life. It's the biggest class we have in the School of Engineering is this one. And I do all of the things, which means I'm spread extremely thin. I do my best. I will do my absolute best to help you all as much as humanly possible. But I am only one human and I only stretch so physically far. So in order to get as much help out of me as possible, I'm going to tell you how to interact with me. So the thing that gets my number one priorities in the week will always be the live stream. So if you need help, coming to the live stream is always the absolute best thing for you to do. And helping me and asking questions and stuff in the stream is the time I am 100% dedicated to helping you, and the time where I will prep things and follow up on Discord bots and stuff as required. If you can do it in the live stream, that's the best because everybody can see this. The next most useful place, and the place I'll put most of my time, is keeping an eye on the public Discord chat. So we'll talk about Discord in a minute. If it's confusing to you, don't stress. There's a slide coming on it. It's all good. But once you get in, you'll see that there will be some general chats and things like that. I will have them open as much as humanly possible, because if you ask a question there, everybody can see the answer. You can probably see what I'm getting at here, right? Then if you get me some stuff that I can deal with quickly, I'll deal with that. And if you're hard to interact with, I will do my best, but I need to be fair to the other 619 students in the course. So I can't often spend a lot of time with one student. I'm sorry. It's just, I'm only one human. So that's how you get the absolute best help out of me. And I want to be very upfront about that. You want help? Come to the live stream. I'll absolutely help you there. Cool. The other thing that I've been doing over the last couple of years is getting the same question over and over and over again, which is fine. That's to be expected. So my solution to that problem is I just continuously make more short form videos that answer questions. So quite often, if there's a common question, I will do my best to make a nice little cool contained video and then give it to all of you so that you can have that. Sometimes you'll get to the point where my answer to your question will be, there's a video for that. I'm not trying to be dismissive when I do that. In fact, kind of the exact opposite. I've already had that question. I think it's a good enough question to have gotten a video. So I've bothered to put the time and the effort into making a video. So go watch that, because that's the best answer I'm ever going to give to said question. Speaking of, go watch the Week Zero videos. So if you haven't seen them already, and I know that you didn't necessarily even find out about these until a couple of days ago, or you may not have heard about them yet, but I've made you an entire playlist of stuff that you can go and watch to help you out before you start semester. And the whole idea here is this entire playlist has been put together from me going to my previous students. People have been through this course before and are now second, third, or fourth year students, like Liam Whiting, who is in the chat right now, was one of my students 2 years ago. I'll go to Liam and be like, hey, mate, what was confusing for you when you started out at uni? And he'll tell me things like, I couldn't find the stupid classroom that you put me in, Dylan. And I'll go, great, I'll make a video for all my future students so that they don't have to fight the same battles as difficultly as we did before. So that's where all the Week Zero videos come from. They've all come from people saying, hey, I wish we knew this piece of information. So please go and watch them if you have the time. They're not all super interesting. I know, I get that, but they're all there because students have said they benefit from them. So it is in your interest to do them. The other thing is, no one's going to tell you any of this stuff. They're just going to expect you to know it, and that's really unfair. So I made a bunch of videos for you. Later. Watch them later. Watch them tonight. If you think there's stuff missing, if you're really confused, please come to the live stream and ask me. But if enough people are asking me the same stuff, I will augment those Week Zero videos. I'll make stuff. I'll add them to you. And we will be able to make a better set of videos to help everybody. Hey, Emma. Do you want to ping me again in a couple of minutes as well so that I remember to talk about PASS. PASS is a thing. I'm going to mention it very briefly here. We might spend a couple of minutes talking about it in a minute. PASS is a thing that exists to help students. If you are confused and a bit lost and need a bit of extra support, you go to PASS. PASS is great because it is led by people who are previous or still current students. And they see the world through your eyes a hell of a lot better than any of your lecturers are going to see the world through your eyes. So they're really good people to go to and work with and get help. So we might talk about PASS in a minute. I'm not sure if I gave you your own custom slide here, if I decided. I think I was going to wait till week one, but we can talk about it at the end. So the number one piece of advice, the number one thing, and I agree with Liam, go to your classes. Go to your classes is definitely the most helpful advice I can give students, even if the first couple are a bit boring, and they're gonna be. Because for a lot of you, a couple of your first classes are gonna be recapping content you've already heard elsewhere. I know, grit your teeth, sit through it. Trust me, go to class. It's super important. We learned through COVID, people not going to classes is bad. You guys all probably learned that as well. So the next thing, though, is getting yourselves organized. How do you line all your ducks up such that when you walk in day one of semester, your brain is spending all of its time trying to learn content rather than sort life admin crap out? So you may or may not know this. I think most students figure this out, but the My Uni app will make you a nice graphical timetable to tell you when your classes are each day. That's very good. A thing that a lot of students have said, though, is they abandon that app really quickly. And the reason they abandon it and they get their own calendars is it's very important once life gets busy to schedule in more than just your classes. But I'm assuming a whole bunch of you are doing part-time work right now. Putting your part-time work in your calendar is really helpful. And you can't do that through the My Uni app. It doesn't let you do that. putting other things like if you play competitive sport and you have to train and all of those types of things, chucking all of that stuff in your calendar can be really helpful. Another thing that's really helpful to put in your calendars for any of your courses that have pre-recorded lectures, like mine does, like Mech 1110 does if you're a mech or something like that, you have pre-recorded lectures that you can watch anytime you want, which are actually a little bit of a problem because heaps of people run out of time in their week. They go, oh, I can watch that anytime I get a spare moment, anytime I get a spare moment, and then they never get a spare moment. And then it doesn't work out for them and they miss content. So it's a really good idea for you to timetable in study periods if that's what you like to do, but particularly time to watch your lecture content if it's been pre-recorded. It really, really helps students. So do that. There are some other stuff around organization that your courses will do to help you out. Sorry if you just heard a ping. That's my stupid emails that I forgot to close. Sorry about that. Most of your lecturers will probably give you some form of roadmap or something like that that tells you how your semester is going to progress, what you're going to learn at different spots, when your assessment items are due. So that can be a good thing if you want to plan your whole semester out. Oh, that's cool. Just that message in the chat. My uni allows to add the calendar to regular calendars. So you're saying you can sync your My Uni calendar with like your Google calendar or something like that. That's a really useful thing. They never used to have that. So if that's true, maybe give that a go. That's a really cool thing if you can do that. That'll help keep you on top of all the other crap. And then the other thing is you can go in and you could put in now then, if you wanted to, when a bunch of your assignments and stuff are due, and you might be able to realize that, oh my God, this week is going to be hell for me because I've got 12 things due in week 7 of semester or something. And maybe that's a good time to like take off work or things like that. So I know I'm laboring the point and I'm sure you've been told to get organized, but get organized. It helps. Cool. Okay. Something kind of completely different, but email etiquette. To be fair, you guys have been really good. On average, most of the emails you've sent me have been fantastic, so I'm not going to labor this point. But please all go and watch the How to Send an Email video. I know it's like 10 minutes on how to send an email, but make sure you know how to do it. It's a super duper useful skill. Some other little things, please use your @UON account. Please don't ever email me from your Gmail account. I will not respond to them because I will not get it, okay? I will only read emails during semester from @UON and @Newcastle, which is the staff thing. So please do that if you're not doing that. Oh, please never send me a Canvas notification. Canvas notifications are the worst thing ever invented. They suck. Don't use them. I haven't met a single academic who doesn't hate Canvas notifications. And by the end of this semester, I doubt any of you students will not hate them as well. So the Canvas thing, if you haven't gotten into it yet, has a messaging and notification system inside of it. It sucks. Discord is superior in absolutely every way. And email is even superior in every way. And you will rarely ever hear me say emails are good things, but they're better than Canvas. Never send me a Canvas notification. Never send any of your academics a Canvas notification unless they've explicitly asked you to, which will be none of them because they suck. So don't do that. I haven't had anybody reply all to an email yet, so that's fine. It normally happens every year where somebody accidentally replies to the whole class, but that, don't worry, you'll be fine. One thing that does happen fairly often, and again, I think it's related to the fact that there's 620 of you in a class, is if I've sent you an email and it's not directed specifically to you, if it's kind of like a generic, hi, everyone, blah, 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 and you reply to that, bear in mind you might be one of 10, 20, 50, 100 people replying to that. So that's okay because it is kind of nice for me to be able to sort of see what email chain this is part of. But if you don't get a reply from me within like a day, send me a standalone email saying, hey, this is in relation to blah, blah, blah. And here is my information or here's my question or whatever. It's just because you got lost somewhere in the 50 replies to that email that have already been sent. So there is a downside to replying to bulk emails in very large classes like this one. Generally, don't do it. But yeah, it's not a huge deal either way. If you're waiting on an email from me, by the way, and you didn't send it within the last hour, I don't have it. Send it again, okay? An hour ago, an hour and a half ago, I thought I was up to date with my email. So if you're waiting on a reply, stop waiting. Send me another email because I'm not going to say it. This is as of what, like 5 o'clock today. So yeah, if you sent me an email before, say, 3 o'clock today and you haven't received a reply, send it again. I don't have your email. Cool. If there's anybody who isn't fully enrolled yet, we need to action this immediately. To all of you who are here right now and have successfully allocated yourself into a timetable and into a tutorial and into a lecture and into a whatever else, well done. That system also stinks. So good work navigating the university system. Honestly, it's one of the hardest things you will have to do. Congratulations, you got through the hard bit. Some of you have still yet to get through the hard bit and you don't have a class. You don't have a tutorial scheduled yet. If that is the case, you need to email me ASAP. I've been spamming you with emails for the last week saying you need to sort your classes out because they start on Monday and you absolutely have to go. So if you don't have a class yet, don't think that you're going to sort that out next week. You're not. It must get sorted out today, tonight or tomorrow. So if you don't have a tutorial yet, please email me. Super important. And please, everybody, go to your week one class. It's mandatory. Most of you, you messed it up 3 times. Well done. You only messed it up 3 times. I'm proud of you. I seriously am. That system is a nightmare. Yeah, week one class is mandatory. So most of you will go into your classes. Not all of you. It depends. But most of you will go into your classes and you'll get a safety spiel, which is if you want to enter this room again, you need to know these emergency exits and fire extinguishers and stuff like that. And if you don't go to that, you're not allowed in week two. And so you're kind of screwed. So absolutely go in week one. Don't think week one is a gimme class. It's not going to be hard, but it's going to be required by law for you to be there. So if something goes wrong and you have like a car accident or whatever, and you can't get to class, that's fine. Adverse circumstances are a thing. They're going to happen. That's okay. Just loop me in as soon as you can so that we can schedule a catch-up class for anybody who has legitimate adverse circumstances, because we have to do this before week two starts, all right? So let me know if you have any dramas getting to your week one classes. All right. We've only got a couple more things, and then I'll throw it over to you guys to do some questions and stuff. Car accidents do happen. Yes, they do. All right, let's have a quick chat about Canvas. I don't know, out of curiosity, actually, could you guys help me understand something? A bit of data mining I've been doing. How many of you used an LMS, a learning management system, something like Canvas or Blackboard or whatever, during high school? I've heard some high schools are using them, but I don't know how many. So is something like Canvas, which I'm showing you now, is this completely new to you? Or is this something you've seen 100 times before? Do you need all your PPE for the first lecture? You don't. It's a nice idea to have it because then we'll check it and make sure it's all up to spec, but you only need it by week two. So you got a little bit of breathing space there. Closest was Google Classroom, use Schoolbox. Okay, I haven't seen Schoolbox before. You did Canvas at school, Google Classroom. Oh, it seems like Google Classroom's pretty popular. Use Canvas, Blackboard, Learn at uni 10 years ago. Yeah. Okay, all right. So I'm gonna blast through this super duper quickly then, because whilst there are some who haven't seen it, there is a week zero video about Canvas, so you can watch that. If you've seen this before, absolutely watch that video on double speed. I'll move pretty quickly here. Classrooms and Teams. Oh, I feel so sorry for you if you had to use Teams. Oh, I hate Teams. Okay. Sick. All right. So I'll go through this, but I'll just go through it at pretty high pace. And if you're confused, please watch the week zero video on Canvas. And if you're still confused, flick me an email. This is Canvas. It's a learning management system. It's a website where you can throw up a whole bunch of stuff. Each of your courses will get its own little icon thingy-mabob. It might not be the same color as mine. But each of your courses will get one of these. I don't know how many of them you have yet. We can talk about pass as well. Not a problem. PA in your courses. I'll talk about that in a second. Don't stress. So each of your courses will get its own page. Plus, you'll see some extra pages like the College Health and Safety one. If you can't see the College Health and Safety one, please let me know. They were supposed to add everybody in ENGG1500 to this course, but I don't know if they have. So each of your sites will get this. I don't know how many of them are up yet. I'm pretty sure MEC1110's up. I don't think ENGG1003 is up yet. I'm not sure. Yeah, they'll work it out. Most course coordinators don't like putting their Canvas sites up early because it can create confusion with students who are worried that they've missed something or something like that. So this is the Canvas site. You don't see it like that. You see it like this. This is student view. I'm pretending to be a fake student now. Basically, come into modules. That's what it's called in the way the uni set it up. And you can get to a whole bunch of content in here. What's going to happen is each week I'll put the lecture content up and I will update this particular page with the new link for you. So this will always have all the data so you can come in and get it there. Also, your assignments will be available in here, and this is where you can come in and do your quizzes and all sorts of stuff like that. You must do all assessment tasks in Canvas or face-to-face in the class. And 1003 is up. Oh, fantastic. So you probably have almost everything up then. But if you don't have a course up yet, don't stress. Don't stress. That course coordinator is just still like setting stuff up in the background. That's good that a lot of them are up though. So yeah, you'll have to do all your assignments in here. You will be able to do this assignment possibly now. It may even be available for you guys right now. And then you'll be able to come in and see your grades as well. You will get more and more assessments in here throughout the semester as I release them. So you can come in here, get all of this. Announcements. I will make a post in here at least once a week, which is basically, here's what's going on in the course. A weird thing that we only noticed this year is I can no longer send those as emails. So I will also make this exact same post in Discord, which means you don't need to use the announcements at all in Canvas. And when you all invariably mute your Canvas notifications, as I know that all students do, no matter how much I tell them whether that's a good idea or not, I know they do. So don't worry, it'll all be in Discord. I've done the assignment, the grade is not visible. Yeah. That's because I haven't made it visible. I'm going to add that to my to-do list. Make A1 grades visible. Thank you for that. I needed to do that. Some other things I want to show you. So this is just all the stuff for the course. That should be... No, that shouldn't be hidden. All right. Something I want to show you. Just going to leave student view for a second. This is my side. And you can see there's a bunch of this stuff that's not green. This is hidden, okay? So it's hidden from you at the moment because it's not ready to go. It's very, 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 very close to ready to go, but I'm going to be making it ready to go over the weekend. So for example, the civil students can't see their discipline-specific content right now. Don't stress. It's meant to be that way. I know. It'll all be ready to go come Monday. You should be fine. I don't think there's too much else to go through with Canvas. I think you guys should be fine. Most of you have used it. It's relatively self-explanatory. So, cool. That's fine. That's fine. We did that. Inductions. All right. So, some of you, as I've mentioned already, will get to go into like physical workshops where there's tools and saws and hammers and stuff like that, and it will require you to do some safety inductions. There is a video on this in the Week Zero playlist. There is also, where did Canvas go? There. If you go into admin, I'll go back to student view. You go into admin, there's this inductions and PPE requirements. This is simply a link to the what to buy video, if you've already seen that, and a link to the inductions video. These are exactly the same videos that are in the Week Zero playlist. They're just duplicated here because trying to find them in the middle of the Week Zero playlist can be a bit of a pain in the ass. So I put them here for you. Cool. Do them. Do them before week one if you can. You don't absolutely have to. We won't kick you out because not everybody will have seen them in week one. But for my own sake, like, if you do them and you can go, hey, Dylan, this link is broken, or I can't see my results or something like that, that gives me a little bit of time to fix it for everybody else. So if you guys are happy to be guinea pigs, smash your way through the inductions and then they're done and then you don't have to worry about them and we can validate that all of the things are working correctly in your week one class so that when you come in week two, everything is flawless and seamless and we don't have to deal with any of the crap that goes with trying to do 620 inductions in a week. Cool. Ah, Discord. All right. The link is not below. I'm about to add the link below. How many of you have used Discord before, and for how many of you is this something new? Hey, getting started questions. That's right. I wanted to talk about that. I don't want to invite people from here, actually. That's the wrong thing for you to do, Dylan. Oh, I don't actually want to show that at all. I want to show something slightly different. Never used Discord. Yeah. Used. Okay. That's cool. A decent number of people have used it. Not everybody has used it. Obviously, not everybody has used it. Thus, there is a video specifically for Discord. I don't expect you to have used it. If you haven't used it, that is totally fine. There's absolutely no expectation. But it is very good. So, if I just edit my stream description. There you go. You might have to refresh your stream, but if you refresh your stream now, in the description should be the link to the server. I might be able to put it in chat. Hey, I can put it in chat. Cool. It's also in chat. And now we don't need any of this. Go away. Go away. Go away. Here. All right. So when you click on that link, you might have to make a Discord account. So go through the motions, make a Discord account, try not to be deemed a bot and have to go and get your account unfrozen. So just follow the steps. Getting the verification email from Discord sometimes takes a little bit of time. They've got really strong security around Discord and particularly stopping bots getting into channels. So it's a thing. It's a good thing overall. They should have a lot of security and they do. When you get in, yes, so much better than Teams. Yes, yes, it is. When you get into Discord, you will need to click on registration up here. You might get like a weird blank screen that looks like it has an error. If you do, just click on registration up the top, okay? And what that will do is it will bring you to this server, read the rules, which basically says this is a moderated community chat. You want to troll people, you want to be a dick, I'm going to boot you out and I'm going to report you for academic integrity. Don't do that. That should be obvious to you all. Don't do that. Fuck around and find out, right? You come to here and you put your student number in, all right? So I don't really have a... Do I have a student number for this? I think I did. I think I made myself a fake student number. Hey, there we go. Once you've done that, you will get access to all of these channels. Can you enable server nicknames as my Discord doesn't use my real name for privacy measures? Never mind. So, what will happen... This point has been explicitly addressed. What will happen when you enter your username is we will check our... Sorry, enter your student number. Is we will check our list. I have a list in the background which goes, yep, we know who this person is. They'll change your username for you so you don't have to worry about it. And then you'll be in the server. There's a bunch of channels in here for you to talk to each other and do stuff and talk to me. So when I was saying before that I will keep my eyes on the... Discord to answer questions. This is where I will spend the overwhelming majority of my time, is answering questions out of kind of these four channels here, or as required, I will add channels as we need to. And I'll add them for like assessment questions and shit like that. So I spend a lot of time here trying to help students out because they're public channels and everybody can see them. But you guys can also answer your own questions and talk and stuff like that. There are off-topic channels as well. If you want to post hilarious engineering memes, post hilarious engineering memes. Post them in the memes channel, though. In order to kind of keep our other channels from being cluttered up with often very legitimately funny things, we've made a channel for that. Go and put it there. If you want to talk to me about playing Warhammer 3 or something like that, then you can do that. But you do it in the off-topic channels, all right? You don't clutter up these channels with that type of stuff. Liam, you can't get into the Discord. You are locked out. The other thing I want to show you very quickly, though, is what's coming. So what is coming for you all is this. Just give me a moment. What you are going to get probably okay, I'm going to address one of those comments in a second. Okay, so what's going to happen in about a week is we're going to run an update to the server. It's not actually an update to the server. This is all here, but we're going to release some more information for you guys. And what you're all going to get is your own Discord channels to talk about your own degree. And you're going to get one for every class as well is going to get its own channel. And then when we put you in teams, each team is going to get its own channel as well. So all of that is contained within here. So that's coming. We're going to release that update next week or the week after. We'll see. There's a few things around the timing. It's all set up and ready to go. I just want to make sure everybody's in the right classes before I release it. So that's coming. So you're going to get all of that ability to communicate. If you have your username to address the, your username will be changed to the current name that is in our system. Not everybody uses that name. It won't go to the system has two pieces of information, what it calls your first name and what it calls your preferred name. And they are not the same for everybody. And that is fine. It's just right now the data I'm pulling is first name, not preferred name. So if you have a different preferred name versus first name, that's fine. Reach out to me and I will help change that for you in Discord. You are allowed to go by your preferred name. I've just got to do some manual stuff behind the scenes. So please let me know. I'm more than happy to help facilitate that. I just got to do the steps. Okay. So, By all means, please reach out to me if you are in the situation where you have a different preferred name. Cool. Yeah, I can do optimized canvas as well if you think it's worth it. This is probably worth doing. Good call, Liam. Okay, so you may end up with a Discord for your particular course, like ENGG1500 has its own. MEC1110 has its own. There's another, and all of these Discords were made by academics. Like, I've made this one for you, and the MEC1110 one was made for you. There's another thing that exists. It's called Optimized Canvas. This is a Discord that was made by students for students. They're a bunch of my old students, and they made this to help each other out during semester. And it's really cool. So I don't have any official involvement in it in any way. No academic is officially involved in it. A few of us were invited to be part of the server. I don't do anything with it. I'm just there in case somebody has a question for me. But Optimized Canvas is the thing. You can engage in this if you would like to. You do you. Cool. Yes, please go and join. We will be using Discord heavily throughout semester. There are a few things, like, as some of you have already pointed out, Teams is problematic. There are a whole bunch of really cool things we do in Discord that will make your life so much easier. How do you join Optimized Canvas is a good question. I don't have a great answer to. I can find out for you. I'll let you guys know next week. I'm actually not sure. is the short answer. I don't know how they're doing it anymore. I know it's not hard. I'm just not sure how you do it. But I can ask for you. I can find out. I will have an update for you before next week. Let me add it to my to-do list. How do you join optimized Canvas? Cool. We've done all this. Yes. So you want to be in Discord. You want to get over this. Sometimes the sign-up procedure is a little bit annoying. I acknowledge that. I also acknowledge that you have been asked to sign up for 408 different pieces of shit so far this week, and I'm asking you to do another one. I know, but overwhelmingly, we use Discord because students say it's a better experience than all of the other systems. Please keep using it. That's why I use it. Granted, full disclosure, it also makes my life easier, but I do it because students essentially demand that we do it. So we do it, all right? So it's there to help you. Hold on. You can't post a link because you're not a mod. I can make you a mod though. How do I make? Let me make her a mod. Add as moderator. Standard moderator. Save. Do you want to try now, Em, and see if you can post a link? Team's bad, Discord good. Correct. Otherwise, yeah, there we go. Sick. Is that so? I'm guessing that's optimized Canvas. So that link in the chat, I think will take you. I'm guessing will take you to optimized Canvas. Otherwise, I can get one for you at some stage. Sick. Thank you, Em. Tutorial numbers. This was coming. Oh, that's what I was mentioning. When this came up a little while ago. Da, 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 da. In here, in Discord, once you get access to your own custom workshop channel, it will say TO1 slash something something. That is your tutorial number. It will be there. You will have that as of next week, and you'll be able to get it out of Discord at all times. And so whenever you forget, you can just grab it straight out of Discord, which you'll have on your phone and whatnot. The reason they are important to me, 320, 620 students across 32 workshops. I don't know where you are when you ask me a question, but if you give me workshop number or tutorial number, then I can track you down to your class, know your project, know your class, know your tutor, know a whole bunch of stuff about you through this one small piece of information. So I will ask you for it constantly. I will sometimes, you will hear me refer to this as a workshop number, and you will also hear me refer to your tutorials as workshops. Up until last year, they were known as workshops. We only changed them to tutorials this year. So my bad habits will fall in, and you'll hear me say workshop. If I say workshop, I mean tutorial. It's just a slip of the tongue. Yeah, that's fine. You're not going to need to have to do this anymore because you'll have them in Discord as of next week. Okay, changing direction again. I know we've got a little bit of whiplash, but we're almost finished here. Accessibility, adverse circumstances, RAPs, academic integrity. So this is kind of basically all of when shit hits the fan, what do you do? I'm trying to think through what the best order to do this in. I had a plan for this and I've lost it. Let's do this. ACs, adverse circumstances. This is a thing that you use when something has gone wrong and you've been unable to complete your tasks as normal. So if you're meant to hand in an assignment or whatever, you come in and you fill out a adverse circumstances, and there is a system for this, and it sucks. Generally, the main problems are this. If you want to fill out an adverse circumstances, according to policy, you have to submit it before the thing is due, which is really hard if you've been in a car accident on the way to class. you also then, you nominate a time for an extension, but then the course coordinator gets to accept or deny that. And if they deny it, or you ask for 3 days and they say, no, you can have one, then your new due date becomes 1 day later. That whole system can take 6 days to process. At which point you're now 5 days late. And even the university acknowledges that their AHC system needs some work. It needs some love. Also, you very rarely actually need it. If you just reach out to me and be like, hey, Dylan, somebody just T-boned me, man. I'm not handing my assignment in today. I'll be like, cool, you're good. Don't worry about it. We'll do these things instead. The other thing that I want to make everybody super duper aware of is extensions of time are not what are necessarily given when there is an adverse circumstance. So if you've had a car accident, absolutely. An extension of time, come and hand it in to me tomorrow. No dramas, that's fine. But if it's an assignment that needs an online submission, I will never give an extension of time for accessibility. And that's not because I'm an asshole. It's actually the exact opposite of that. I don't want you to have extensions of time because the minute an assignment is due in my course, I want your brain to have moved on to something else. And people who end up with extensions end up then screwing up the thing that comes after that task. And in my course, everything gets bigger as it goes. What is much better for you is for me to say, cool, you were sick for 4 days. Do 75% of the assignment and upload 75% of the assignment, and I will mark it as though you have done the entire thing. That is not only better for you because it actually reduces your workload, it also gets you to do on-time submissions, which is a really important skill to learn, and it's actually way fairer on the cohort as a whole because now I don't have to withhold information from the 619 other students because I'm waiting for one person with an extension to hand something in. So what I want you to take away from this is talk to me if you don't think you'll be able to get something in on time. If you already know for a fact that you are going to struggle a little bit throughout semester getting things in on time because maybe you're a little neurodivergent or you've got this or you've got that or whatever, or you're living out of home or I don't know, something that is going to make life harder for you. There's a group called Accessibility on campus, and their whole job, it's not spelt that way, by the way. It's spelt like Access Ability. It's a typo. Their whole job is to help people in difficult situations get what's called an RAP, a reasonable adjustment plan, and make a plan with their course coordinator in advance to help them be successful. The whole point of this is that I want you to be a successful engineer at the end of the day, and I will give you certain challenges to overcome to learn to be and then reward you for being a successful engineer. And some of those challenges will be hard. And I want them not necessarily to be hard, but they're meant to be challenging. What I don't want is for you to fail one of those challenges because of something that has fuck all to do with university and everything to do with the rest of the world screwing you over at some stage, right? Or making things more difficult for you. So let's get you as much support as humanly possible to help you fight those battles so that you've got the mental capacity or capability to fight the battles in class that we want you to do so that you can become an awesome engineer. That's the goal here, okay? And be open and talk to us about this so that we can help you as much as possible. That's like the overwhelming big picture thing I want to give you here. Went into enrollments and did like the auto select classes. Email me. Enrollments are terrible. They'll just put you in anywhere. They may have done the right thing. They may not have done the right thing. Please just send me an email. Tell me who you are, what your student number is, where they enrolled you into, and I'll check. Let's just make sure. Broken leg, foot, but should be off crutches, maximum of 2 weeks. Do I bother getting one? No, maybe. So the other thing in this situation, all right, so you've got somebody who's knows they've broken their leg, so they know in advance. The advantage in this case of getting an RAP is that once there is a piece of paper I can go to the workshop and say, whilst you would normally kick somebody out because they have crutches and you absolutely won't be allowed in a workshop in crutches because it's dangerous, normally they would have to say, no, you're not allowed to enter. Once we have the document, we can get our safety team involved and be like, can you sign off on the risk analysis, which says this person's allowed to walk through the door, blah, blah, blah. Can we put them near the emergency exit? Can we, and we can put a plan in place. Will you get an RAP in 2 weeks? No. The paperwork won't happen that quickly, but at the very least, it could be a good idea to start some of these conversations. So, or at least start them with your course coordinator so we can put the things in place. If you just show up on day one, we'll be like, no, man, you're not coming in. It's a safety hazard. See you later. So reach out, talk to people. The other nice thing, I suppose, that I should point out about accessibility is, maybe you feel comfortable emailing Dylan about the fact that you broke your leg. Not everybody is necessarily going to feel as comfortable doing that about the types of things. So accessibility can run as a buffer between you and your course coordinator if you're less comfortable having a discussion with them. And that's a real thing. You guys, mainly right now, I'm aware that my cohort is 18-year-old, 9-foot-tall and bulletproof. And these things don't affect you. Your mental health is great. Your living situation is solid. Come back to me in 4 or 5 years when some of the challenges have maybe gotten a little bit harder. So I tell you this now, knowing most of you probably don't need it, but for anybody who does need it, or anyone in a couple of years who ends up in a situation where they do need it, knows about it and doesn't have to fight the entire world's battles by themselves. Cool. ChatGPT, we're going to talk about. Don't worry about it. Sweet. And we're done. Okay, so as of this stage, that's all the stuff I wanted to go through. Thank you for engaging in the conversation with me up until this point. Please throw out any questions that you have and would like to talk about. If you don't want to throw them in the stream, you can chuck them in the Discord as well, and I'll have a look at the Discord. If you've asked a question and I haven't answered it, please ask it again. I'll get back to it. This is, I know you will hear this thing that there are no dumb questions and stuff like that. There are absolutely dumb questions. There are really dumb questions. There are things that most of the time people would feel embarrassed about asking. Ask them now. Now is your time to look like an idiot, because this is a safe space, okay? I think I've done enough to break down some barriers here and say there's nothing to be ashamed of by looking like an idiot. So please throw your dumb questions out now. Spitting facts, yes, Liam. Do I have to attend all lectures? I have a math lecture on a tough day to organize. Oh, this is a really good question. I think I've got some of this comment coming up in a few weeks. The short answer is no, you don't have to attend all lectures. The slightly longer answer is there is a direct correlation between people who attend lectures and people who do well at university. And there's a direct correlation between people who don't attend lectures and those who fail. It is, the way I like to describe it is, because people ask me all the time, hey Dylan, do I have to come to this stream live? And the answer is absolutely not. Of course you don't have to be here live. I'm talking on a fucking camera. You can watch it later. You can not watch it at all. You'll probably battle through. Not going to lectures live is like watching recorded grand finals of a sport. They're just not the same. They don't have the impact once you know that they're recorded. It doesn't matter that you haven't seen the content and it's brand new to you. As soon as it's not live, somehow to the human being, it loses value. Do what you will with that information. If you've got like a 13-hour day and you have to then commute to Sydney or something, bail on the lecture. You're fine. But just acknowledge that, okay, you might have to work. You will have to work harder to catch up if you're re-watching lectures than if you get them straight the first time. So, short answer, no. Bail on all of your lectures if you want. Just, yeah. I'm going to try and do these in order, but obviously I will fail miserably at that. What do we need to bring for the first week of uni? Pen and paper is a good idea. Only because it's super flexible and you might need to jot some stuff down and things like that. Most of you will have a laptop. Bring a laptop, pen and paper, shitload of Red Bull and you'll be fine. Wear enclosed shoes. Everybody should be wearing enclosed shoes for the entirety of the first week at a bare minimum, because a bunch of your spaces will require you to have enclosed shoes. Other than that, in your first week, you will be told. If you'd like to get ahead, go watch the week zero videos and they'll tell you about if you specifically need any PPE or any of that kind of jazz. But for your first week, bring a pen and paper, laptop if you plan to use a laptop. Oh, bring Mozzie repellent. Oh, they are terrible right now. Like, go and buy an entire can of AeroGuard. You will need it. It is awful right now. Like, they're always bad. They are atrocious. Get some AeroGuard, get a pen and paper. And with that, you will survive. A laptop will help you out as well, and enclosed shoes are required. Other than that, go watch the Week Zero What to Buy video. It was specifically made to answer that question. But what you need for week one, pen and paper. How many classes are actually still available to enroll in? Very few, like 4 or 5, I think, out of 32. So that's one of the reasons I need to sort it as soon as possible. When do we need our uni ID by? Week 2, for your class in week 2. Try and get it in week 1. Are you all coming tomorrow to welcome week? Whatever that thing is called. I think all of you should have an activity on tomorrow to come in welcome week, O week orientation, to do some stuff. Get it tomorrow if you can. That'll just skip a heap of lines for you. But anytime during week 1, please have your uni ID by week 2. No, the course outline is not available yet. It's not meant to be available. It will become available at some stage, but my course outline is deliberately not available. It'll be available by Monday of week 1. I don't want you to have a look at it yet. I want to talk through it with you in the week 1 lecture, or make a video about it. Should I make a separate Discord account for my uni Discord? You don't have to. It's a good question. Some people decide with Discord, they have their personal one and they're like, oh, what do I want to do here? There's absolutely nothing wrong with keeping it the same, because all of the servers will change your name to your legal name and whatnot. So you should be fine. The only caveat I will say to that is if you DM somebody, it will show your username. Username is, I think, what they call it. So if your name in Discord is something offensive, I would make a new one for this. And if you're the type of person who struggles to separate in their head their work from their social life, then maybe make a new one. I'm the exact opposite of that. So this is my ENGG1500. This is Optimized Canvas. This is a bunch of the other courses I'm involved in. These are my friends. These are my gaming ones. I just have them all combined because that's how I am as a person and I don't care. But there are some people who decide they would prefer to make their own, and there's nothing wrong with that. Are tutorials compulsory? Yes, and they are subject to what's called mandatory attendance. If you miss 3 tutorials, you will automatically fail the course. Your tutorials are absolutely compulsory. Make sure you go to them. Was this so bad? I've been on TEDs for the past few weeks and been eaten alive. Oh, I know. They're terrible, right? And engineering precinct is atrocious. Yeah, it's nasty. Showing up tomorrow? Yeah, coming tomorrow? Cool. Some of you will see me. I'll be around for at least a little bit of tomorrow. We're not allowed to call it O Week anymore. No, we're not allowed to call it O Week anymore for reasons that baffle me. Do I do chemical engineering? Will I be your teacher? Nope. I do all of the engineerings, and so I do none of the engineerings. So I won't be the person face-to-face in front of you. You will have a person called Simon Iverson, who is a fantastic chemical engineer. Really, really good. I will be in every single one of the classrooms for like 10 minutes as I bounce around between my 32 classes a week. Mandatory attendance, be tracked with a Google Sheet or the app. You've been here before. There's a video for that. It's in the playlist. Yes, my Google Sheet, the one that I made that everybody else also uses, will be available. The explanation for those of you who are missing this, and that's fair. There is an app to track your to track. Track is absolutely the wrong word to use. To log your attendance when you show up to classes. The app is notoriously buggy, and so there is a secondary system that I built. If the app bugs out, you can record your attendance independently so that you don't have to stress. There's no telling people that if you miss too many classes, you're going to fail creates just all sorts of leveling of stress that shouldn't be there, because people show up and then the app doesn't log their attendance and then they get stressed, which is dumb. So my solution is you have a backup way of logging attendance. It's a really simple Google form. And you can fill that out. It's all in it'll be explained to you in week one, or it's in the week zero videos. Don't stress about mandatory attendance. Just come to class and you will 100% be fine. I will never let the app hurt you on my fucking watch. If you are coming to class, you will be fine. Don't worry about it. Do we need to allocate tutorials to our timetable? Yes, or you will not be allowed to enter. You must have them in because they have hard caps on student numbers. Like, I'm not allowed to let more than 25 people into a room. So if you're not allocated, you will not come in. How many tutorials are we meant to have a week? Good question. So you'll have a tutorial for my class. You'll have the lecture for my class. For most of your classes, you will have some form of lecture thing and some form of face-to-face class. I think that's pretty standard now. I think it's pretty standard to have either 2 or 4 hours of lecture and a 2-hour face-to-face per class. So you'll have one for maths and one for me and one for ENGG1003 or something like that. So you should have one. It's not always called a tutorial though. So in ENGG1003, it's probably called a computer lab instead of a tutorial. I think in Mech 1110, if you're doing that subject, I'm pretty sure it's called a computer lab as well, but it serves the same sort of purpose. Hopefully that answers your question. For me, you have one lecture, one tutorial a week. That's it. Most of the others are similar, but not exactly the same. If you're late, one of the beautiful examples of why I use YouTube instead of Zoom, that piece of shit, is you can just rewind it. You can just drag the thing back to the start and watch it from the start. Your comments are going to be all out of order, but you can watch it from the start. And if you're only like 10 minutes late to one of these things, or you have to pause it to go to the bathroom or whatever, you can not only rewind it, you can watch the bit that's already happened at double speed so you can catch up, which is like so much better for students. I'm ignoring the car club conversation, by the way. Is there only meant to be a lecture and tutorial timetabled in my timetable? For this course, yes, that is correct. If you have the lecture in this time slot and a tutorial, whenever there is a tutorial, you are golden. Just go to that tutorial and you'll be sweet. If I have to miss the tutorial due to a funeral, is it worth doing adverse circumstances? Oh, this is a really good question. So if you have to miss a tutorial for a particular reason, do you put your AC in? The answer is no, because the adverse circumstances system is so broken by, this would be thousands of students having to submit these every week, it would just fall over. So the normal rule is no. It's probably worth flagging it with your lecturer in an email, just saying, hey, this is my situation, I'm doing this, do you need me to put an AC in? To which my answer to you will be, no, please don't do that. But now you have a record, it's written down somewhere, and if I turn around in a couple weeks and be like, what the fuck, you've missed two classes, you can be like, yes, but remember this email, which I clearly don't remember, but you can pull it out and be like, hey, you said that this was okay. So flagging them with your course coordinator sometimes is a good idea. You're going to have to get a little bit of a read on who your course coordinator is and whether they want to hear from you or not, because a lot of them just couldn't. Like, they don't have time to be looking at 600 emails, right? So, yeah. In my case, I would like you to just write it in a very brief summary email and flick it to me. Don't put one in the system. I will not look at it. How up to date should we be for maths? Good question. Many of you may have been forced to do or gotten the opportunity to do, I don't know which way you want to look at it, the maths placement quiz. Just if you haven't done a lot of maths in the last year or so, it kind of checks on your status. Look, maths will start at an extremely basic level, like a year 10 level, maths will start there. The thing is, they will cover all of year 10, 11, and 12 maths in 3 weeks, or something crazy like that. Which is actually good, because it means if you're a little bit rusty, you get a little bit of time to blow the cobwebs off, which is quite nice. If you're pretty on top of it and you just finished, like, extension HSC maths, your first couple weeks of maths will be recap. And that's fine, but the next couple weeks won't be. So don't get lazy and stop going. It's a real trap for people who are actually really quite good at maths, end up doing really badly, because they go for the first couple weeks and like, I've seen all of this, I don't need to go to any of this. And then it accelerates, and then you get left behind, and then you struggle. So sit through the lectures, even if they're recap. It's good for you. Deal with it. You'll be fine. Will tutorials be Zoom or face-to-face? Face-to-face, absolutely mandatory. That's a good question. All tutorials in this course are face-to-face because you are physically in a workshop building something in a team. There is no online option. Some maths do have two chutes, so don't skip. Oh, cool. I didn't realize that. Maths chutes are generally really good value. They do like their cool whiteboard exercises and stuff like that. Definitely make time to go to your chutes. Unless you're doing physics is 7 hours a week. Oh, hold on. I think. I don't know this. Previously, physics used to do this. You would have like a 3 hour lab, but it only ran every second week. So it averaged out to be 6 hours a week, but you kind of had an off week and an on week or something like that. So hopefully check that. Hopefully you don't have to do 7 hours of FaceTime. But I will tell you this. If they've got you doing 7 hours of FaceTime, there is a really fucking good reason for it, okay? We absolutely need to justify getting students on campus, and we won't run classes unless we have a really good reason, face-to-face classes, unless we have a really good reason why we have to. Like, I could have done this in a lecture, right? I could have booked a lecture theater. I could have said, all of you need to come in for this. But that's not true. You don't need to come in for this at all. And thus, I will never bring you in for any reason other than I have a super good reason for it, okay? So if you've got a face-to-face thing scheduled, hopefully, there's a really good reason for that and you should go. We aren't using Zoom. Nope, no Zoom at any stage. Zoom is the pits. So everything for me will either be live on YouTube or pre-recorded YouTube or on Discord. There is no need for Zoom. There is no need for Teams. There is no need for any of that. Cool, 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 cool. Is the maths placement test hard? I think the whole point is that depends on who you ask, right? Maths is one of those things that if you've been in it and doing it recently, it's not too bad. If you've gotten rusty with it, it's really pretty hard. So the whole point is if you find the maths placement test hard, then let's get you into a maths course that's going to do a better job of bringing you up to speed and making sure you've got your fundamentals down. If you don't find it hard, then let's get you in the class that'll move a bit quicker to stop you getting bored in that situation. So it depends on the person and that depends on the experience. Yeah, the idea is if you've done advanced maths last year, you should be fine in the maths placement test. That's the intention. But not everybody's in that situation, right? So it's like, how do we put a little bit of a measuring stick in there? If you emailed me with anything other than a UON email, it absolutely went to my spam. So please send it to me properly. What is the recommended hours of study outside of allocated class? Yeah, really good question. It's in the order of 10 to 12, I'm going to say 10 hours a week for an average student to get an average mark. So an average student in engineering, does anybody know what was the ATAR to get into engineering? Anybody know what it was? I have no idea what it was. I don't ever look at ATARs, but out of curiosity, 85, 75, 75, 70. As in the ATAR you needed with bonus points or without bonus points? 86 back in your day, Liam. So, was 82 then 75? Cool, yeah, that math checks out. So, if that's what the cutoff was, what do you reckon the average ATAR in the room is? We don't need to do this in the chat. I have no idea what the average ATAR in the room is, but the cutoff was somewhere between 75 and 82. So, the average is whatever you think that is, and then place yourself on that bell curve, which means you're probably somewhere in the middle. The average mark in a large engineering course is about 65, not because I ever force you into a bell curve, and I will die on that hill that there should not be people forced into a bell curve, and I never do it, but statistically the average mark will be 65 to 70. So if you were somebody who had the average ATAR and you do 10 hours a week, which I know is the original question, the expectation is 10 hours a week, you will get about a 65 to a 70. If you want to do better than that, do more hours. If you had a lower ATAR, you might need to do more hours to get that. If you started with a really high ATAR and you don't give a shit and you just want to get like 55%, which is fine, P's make degrees. They make bad ones, but they do make degrees. Then you'll probably get away with like 5 hours a week. So the expectation is 10 hours a week per course. Four courses, 40 hours a week, full-time job. Courses that have more face time should have less outside of hours work, but it doesn't always work that way. That's my very long answer to your very short question. I hope it was helpful. I do understand that it's a little bit of a politician's answer and I didn't really tell you, but it depends on the person. Sick. All right. How are we doing otherwise? I'm sure I've missed some things in the chat. But how are we doing? Have I lost my viewers yet? Oh, it's holding pretty steady, actually. So, is there anything else you guys want to know? Is there anything else I can help you with? Is there anything you want to know before you get into uni? Dumb questions that you felt nervous about asking up until this point? This is how I like to run my streams. I try and do some Q&A at the start. I go through a bunch of content and try and discuss with you as we go. And then I throw it open for general Q&A at the end. This often ends up leading into like some really specific rabbit hole tangents that we go down. But that's okay. Off topic, do I make money from YouTube? Actually, absolutely not off topic. I should have addressed this earlier. I really need to make a week zero video on this. This is 100% worth stating very clearly. I have not monetized my YouTube channel. I never will monetize my YouTube channel. I get no money from being on YouTube whatsoever, and I never will. I have not enabled the sponsor button. I do not have a Patreon. You cannot give me money this way, and I cannot get money from YouTube. Why? Because I want you all to be 100% certain that I use YouTube because I believe it is in the best interest of the students, not in any personal interest of myself. I think this is a really important thing to establish just so that you know there are no kind of underhand deals or anything like that going on. Also, that means I get no money off any ads that get played. That's 100% YouTube cashing that shit in. So go get an ad blocker and block the hell out of it. Cool. I'm just trying to... I see a whole bunch of questions that came through and I'm trying to find where I was. There I was. Are there ways to hold a course book from the library for more than a week at a time? Generally not, because if it's required for a course, the whole point is that it can cycle quite quickly. If you need to hold it for more than a week at a time, maybe you need to buy it. The other thing is, though, you can hold it for a week, return it, take it back out 2 seconds later. So there's nothing wrong with that, but if somebody else has joined the wait queue, then that's not a fair thing to do anymore. So just refresh it, refresh it, refresh it. My old supervisor had a book on loan for like 3 years that every 2 weeks or something, he refreshed his loan on it. It was a fun thing that he did on Friday. Are our assignments going to be group work or solo? Good question. Your assignments are going to be solo. So you are going to work in a team to do a thing, do a project, solve a problem, build a thing, test it out, do all of that. And that's the thing where you want to be in a team, because you're going to want to build the thing together and stuff like that. And there are really good reasons. And people actually quite enjoy it, which I know sounds weird. Most people hate group work. There's a reason I don't say group work. I say teamwork. And actually, most people really enjoy the teamwork aspect of this. And one of the reasons they enjoy it is you are assessed individually. So somebody beside you being crap doesn't necessarily pull your grade down, and in some ways makes you look better by comparison and can push your grade up. So all of your assignments will be individual. Even your group project, we reserve the right to not give every member of the group the same grade. So if you have a shit team member, I won't ever let that drag you down. You need to do enough good engineering project management to, you know, address that fact and do your best to work with that person and all those types of things. But if you do so, I will 100% give the person standing next to you a failing grade and give you 95%. I have no problems with that. I think it's extremely important that you are assessed individually, often to my detriment because it makes my workload 4 times higher than it needs to, but I think it's bullshit assessing people as teams when they can't control their team. So, is there a streamer every week? Yep. Same bat time, same bat place. I mentioned in one of the week zero videos. Cool. Look at me remembering things. Absolutely not, Liam. Do you know if the renewable energy degree will become fully accredited? Yes. I do know the answer to that. I'm not allowed to say, not because there is a problem. It's simply there is a policy and a procedure in place which stops me telling you that the degree is accredited or will be accredited once it jumps through some final pieces of shit. That information we should be able to be made available to you very soon. I would suggest you ask in class. Okay? Am I better off catching the train or driving to campus? If you're anywhere remotely near a train station, catch the train. The parking on campus is bad. The traffic around campus, they're doing the roadworks. You may or may not know this, everybody, but they're doing huge roadworks just down the road from campus. It's horrible. I'm driving in and out of it every day at the moment. What used to be a 10-minute drive home took me 28 minutes to do today. It's pretty nasty. If you can get the train, you should. I understand not everybody lives near a train station. That's not a real possibility for people. Try both out in your first week and see how it goes, but the traffic's going to get nasty quick. So you might have no option other than the train. Where can we find study material and homework? Oh, it'll be given to you. Don't stress. It's coming. Now, most of your courses will structure out what your first few weeks are meant to look like. I encourage you to do the things that you get given. And you should be pretty solid if you do all the things you've been given. Don't burn yourself out in week one trying to do 10,000 things. Do the shit I've explicitly told you to do in the week zero videos. But other than that, just work through at the pace we give you stuff. We'll give you enough stuff to be getting on with. Yeah. Yeah, look. Don't. Yes, it's hot in my room. I can't have an aircon because the background noise over the speaker ruins the audio quality, and I don't want you guys to have to listen to a fan coming through my microphone for 2 hours. So I can sit and sweat and sweat and sweat for 2 hours. It's fine. I have hydration. Is it hard to drop from full-time to part-time? E.g. 3 classes instead of 4. Poorly posed question, interestingly, because 3 classes actually still counts as full-time. So for all of you to know this, most of you are probably enrolled in 4 classes right now. The university and government considers you a full-time student, even if you're only enrolled in three. And I say this because, is it easy to drop a class? Absolutely. Just unenroll. And then you're out of the class and you have no obligations and you can still claim like Centrelink and stuff as a full-time student with three classes. The only exception to that is a visa. If you're an international student, the visa requirement is four classes. But if you're a domestic student, you can just drop a class whenever you want. You don't need to tell anyone. Please tell your teammates if you're in a team. But other than that, you don't need to tell anyone. You can just go, screw that Dylan guy. I'm out of here. Drop the class, walk away. It's often a good idea to talk to somebody if you are going to drop their class, if there's a reason for it, because maybe that reason is artificial and there can be something we can work around, but you can super easily do it. All of you should consider at some stage in your university potentially dropping to three classes. It is not failing to do three classes a semester and pass them all. That's fine. That's a very good way for many of you to be successful. Again, right now, you're 18 years old, 9 foot tall and bulletproof. And what do you mean? I don't need to drop a class. You might by the time you become a second, third or fourth year. Or maybe even something rough happens in your first year. It is not failing to do three classes a semester. It is not failing to do two classes a semester. It is not failing to do one class a semester. That's fine. Find a way for you to succeed. It's super easy to drop classes. And then you can talk to people, they're called program conveners. If you're going to go a little bit off track and be like, hey, I only took three classes this semester and next semester. What should I take the one after? Because I'm worried about not having all the prior knowledge or whatever. And a program convener helps you restructure your program in a way that will work through what will now be like 5 years at sort of four or 5 or 6 years at maybe 75% loading capacity. It's a really good question. And I'm very happy to talk more about it as needed. Would you prefer email or Discord for contacting me? Either at the moment is fine. I personally have no problems with you contacting me on Discord, but I want to be really clear. Most of your other course coordinators are going to hate you for doing that. So don't slide into your DMs of your lecturers. But I live on Discord, so I have no problems with that. Again, I would much prefer, wherever possible, and it's not always possible, for you to post these things in a public forum such that the answer can go to more than just you and it can go to everybody. But obviously, if it's personal, do that. If it's anything that's like super official university business, it's going to have to be an email anyway. So you can kind of skip a step there. But if you're not sure, do it as a Discord message. What are you going to learn through this semester? You're going to learn how to be a kick-ass engineer and kind of everything that goes with that. So we're going to teach you a bit about how I as an engineer view the world and how I problem solve. Then we're going to combine those things to design a solution to a real world problem. So it depends on what discipline you're doing. If you're a mechanical engineer, you will make a wind turbine capable of charging my phone. That's your project. And in week 12, I will hand you my phone and say, plug it in. Let's see if it charges. So you will learn a bit of like aerodynamics and a bit of design theory and a bit of engineering problem solving and a bit of this and a bit of that and a bit of whatever. And you'll bring all of that together. In parallel to that, I'm going to teach you how to communicate. So basically, I'm going to teach you how to report on things, because the crappy turbine that you build the first time isn't the end of the engineering process. Realistically, it's the first step. And then you write about that and then you hand it to somebody else and then they take over from there and they move on. So there's no good engineering without good documentation. I despised report writing, by the way, when I was an undergrad. So full disclosure, I hated it. And now I am absolutely forced to admit that, yeah, we so desperately all need to get better at this. And I will teach you how to be good at it. I'm not necessarily going to say you'll like it, but you will be good at it by the time you finish your course. So that's basically what you're going to learn in this course. Go watch the week one. The week one lecture's not up. The week one lecture will go up tomorrow, and it'll give you a bit of a taste of this. What does fully accredited mean? Okay, so very quickly, there is a group of people called Engineers Australia who go around to who do a whole bunch of stuff. But one of the things, and the thing that's pertinent in this context, is they go around to universities and say, hey, you create mechanical engineers and electrical engineers and whatevers. Are they good? Are they worthy of being called engineer? And they go through your degree and everything you teach, and they talk to your graduates, and they talk to people who employ your graduates, and they go like, yeah, you guys kick ass at making these engineers, or no, you don't, and we're not putting our sticker of approval on you guys. Normally, this is just an absolute no-brainer thing. The reason accreditation has come up is a couple of years ago, the University of Newcastle started offering three brand new degrees: medical engineering, aerospace engineering, and renewable engineering. And the way the process works is you get what they call provisional accreditation, which is so far so good accreditation, and then you get full accreditation, which is, yep, you guys, you're great, you're killing it. With our programs that have only been 3 or 4 years old, we don't have graduates yet who are in the workforce, which means they can't interview employers of said graduates, so they can't give the, yes, you guys are all good, final green tick, and they only come around to do accreditation once every couple of years. We were accredited last year. No, yes, last year we were accredited, and we're waiting for the final thing to come out, which will give all of the final green ticks to say we're all good, because last year was the first year that we had graduates in the workforce in some of these degrees. You're doing a double. Both the info sessions are tomorrow at the same time. Would you recommend going to one over the other? Yeah, go to the one you're most interested in. Maybe go to maths. The only reason I say go to maths is because this exists for Mecca, for engineering. You've got a bunch of week zero videos. You'll learn maybe some cool stuff, but like, I can tell you, you'll have the opportunity to find out anything you've missed with me. I don't know if you'll get that opportunity with math, so maybe go to maths. Speaking of the government, Centrelink is doing my head. Yeah, good luck to you. If one of my classes ends at 1 p.m., how do I get to the other class starting at 1 p.m.? Good question. So your class won't end at 1 p.m. It will end at 12:55. And your next class won't start at 1 p.m. It will start at 1:05. So you can see this. I have this documented. Let's go all the way back to the start. You guys didn't see this because I was stressed out of my mind trying to get the stream working. But all of my things will say the stream starts at 5:05, because there is people who will have had a class that finished at 5 p.m. and they will need to get to a computer or get on their phone or whatever and watch the stream. And this is the 5 minutes of grace period that you get, basically. So I'll go live generally when I don't have technical issues at 5 to 5 or something like that, talk trash with you guys for 10 minutes, and then at 5 past I will start, which means if somebody wants to doesn't want to listen to the trash talk at the start and they want to get on at 5:04, they can do that, and we'll start on time wherever possible. What is the process like if you want to transfer to a different uni but don't want to start over completely? It's generally fairly easy. You have to talk to that uni. They are the ones who control everything. We don't do anything. We're not allowed to do anything. It's entirely on that new university. Most universities who are teaching engineering in Australia have all kind of more or less agreed on what a first year engineering set of subjects should look like, which means if you transfer pretty early to a similar degree, you go from mechanical to mechanical, you'll be fine. If you go from software to enviro, you'll be much less fine. But they'll generally give you credit for something like 50 to 75% of the classes you've done before. Our policy basically says that. It's pretty easy. It happens all the time. How are the winter summer courses structured? If I send them, will my last year be one or two courses? Okay, so I'm yet to meet a single student who has been able to accelerate their program by doing winter and summer courses. Every single one of them has burnt out and has had to take less courses in their other semesters. It's a really dangerous game to play. You can try it, but it's a really dangerous game to play. What winter and summer courses are good for is when your timetable is already messed up because you're taking like three subjects, and then maybe you can take one of the ones you missed over summer and kind of realign your timetable. That's what they're for. That's what they're really helpful at. Trying to speed run your degree is a really dangerous strat. I'm not saying you can't do it. I'm just saying my personal opinion is if I was a betting man, I would put money on you burning out much faster than you finishing your degree. So be careful with it. You can do it. You do you. Don't let me tell you how to live your life. I can't make tomorrow's info sesh. Is there a way to catch up on stuff? Probably not. They might send some slides and stuff around, but I never really think their slide decks are of that much value. Don't lose too much sleep over it, man. You'll be fine. Just go to all of your classes next week and check all of your emails, okay? Because if we want you to know something, we'll be emailing you or it'll be coming out in your first classes. Just go to all your week one classes. You'll be fine. It'll obviously, life will be easier for you if you have been. Oh, that's what I wanted to say. If you're coming in tomorrow, or if you're like, do I need to come in tomorrow? One thing to do is go around and physically find all of your classrooms so you know how to get to them, because you just don't need that stress in week one, trying to get lost on campus, which is a horrible place to navigate. Go find all your classes tomorrow when you're on campus. How do we get into Formula Student? I will talk to you about that at length. Don't worry. You don't at this stage. Nobody gets into the Formula Student clubs in semester one. They do it at the end of ENGG1500 and we deliberately integrate them then. Don't stress. Computer Systems is accredited. Correct. Why is there no course outline at campus for this course? Because course outlines are horrible things to give students at this point in their career, and if I could block them all, I would. You are going to get a bunch of information from me about what the assessments are, why they are, and why they are when they are, and I don't really want you thinking about them until that point. So it will officially be released on Monday, because I have to release it on Monday, but... You will get all of the information you need from me when you need it from me in the form of videos and releases and stuff like that. So it is coming. Don't stress. No matter what your requirements are, go to class every week. And that doesn't change whether you have a course outline or not. So it's coming. You'll have it Monday for peace of mind. It is not meant to be available yet. Don't stress. You're all good. I have 13 classes a week. Is that normal? Maybe. You should have probably not that many. That sounds like a few too many. How many hours is recommended for studying in this course? If you are, we had a conversation about this. If you're an average student, so you got like an 85-ish ATAR and you want to get an average mark of something about 65% in this course, then the expectation is 10 hours a week. That's the default. Info session 2022 is Dylan speed drinking 100 cans of Red Bull. Lies. Not really. Do I recommend taking less subjects as an athlete? See how you go. That's a very good logic, and I can very much see why you would end up taking less subjects as an athlete. The counterpoint to that is most of the highly competitive athletes I know do better the more they have on. They're a bit of a weird case. So see how you feel. Don't be afraid to acknowledge in yourself, you know what, I'm overworked here and I'm going to drop back to a bit less. Does anybody know tomorrow? So the question is, what time is tomorrow's info sesh? If anybody would like to answer that, could you please answer it with what degree you're doing? Like, are you Mecha Aero? Are you this? Are you something else? And what time? I think they're all at the same time, but they're not always all at the same time. So just to make sure we don't mess anything up here. Yeah, Formula Student, I interpret it as the new racing stuff. Yeah, or all the new teams is cool. So for those of you who don't know what we're talking about, there's these new teams, Newcastle University teams, and they're student teams. So they're undergraduate students, second, third, fourth year students, and they build solutions and compete in competitions. One of them is New Racing, where they build an electric race car and race it every year. They just got back from comp like a month, 2 months ago. One of them is New Rocketry. I'm the academic lead for New Rocketry. They build a rocket that goes 10,000 feet in the air. It's super duper cool. There's New Marine, which builds an autonomous boat that can go around and do all of these objectives and launch a UAV and launch a sub and go and find sea mines. That's its job. But they don't call it that. Do all kind of stuff like that. And I think I'm allowed to say this now. I think it's been officially released. As of next year, we're hoping to start up New Brewing as well, which would be really cool. So we'll brew and we'll make ethanol, make beer, stuff like that, which should be really cool as well. So it's something you can all get involved in, regardless of degree. The current new teams do have a bit of a bias towards mechanical, mechatronics, aerospace, but we're actively working on diversifying that right now. We are, honestly, we've got enough mecha aeros. We want electricals, we want chemicals. Like, New Brewing was made for the chemicals and the renewables, like biofuel, stuff like that. We're trying to broaden that out. We want softwares, we want enviros, we want all of that in them. So new teams are super duper cool. They're one of the greatest things you'll see at any university in the whole country. And you will find out heaps more about them towards the end of semester, because one of the requirements for getting into new teams is completing ENGG1500. So you'll find out more about it as we go. Oh, yeah. Pass plus tutorials plus lectures. I hadn't considered pass. A program advisor doesn't fix your classes. You fix your own classes through MyHub. That's what you need to do. Jump into MyHub, follow the stuff there. You should be cool. Cool. All right. Is there any other questions? I'm assuming the answers in the chat have hopefully answered the what time is the stuff on tomorrow. You should have emails and stuff about it as well, but you know. Is there anything else I can help anybody with at this stage? Oh, yeah, we should talk a little bit about pass very quickly. And I'll do some more of this next week. Can you send me an email to say add some pass content to your week one lecture, week one live stream, so that it's there and I make a slide for it and you can help me vet it and stuff. But pass is peer assisted study something or other. And the whole idea is that you're here at this university and you've got a lecturer standing out the front saying a bunch of crap at you. You've got a tutorial where you're going to come in and do maybe some practice problems. And there's a good chance, and then you're going to be told, all right, now go and do 6 more hours of work by yourselves. What? The idea of PASS is it gets a group of students together, all doing the same course, and it gets a PASS leader, somebody who's been there, done that. And they can be like, hey, look, maybe you guys should talk about these things. This could be helpful to you. They can guide you a little bit in these study sessions and create an environment where you can kind of min-max your study sessions, like optimize them out. You don't have to go. They are 100% optional. It's never been in ENGG1500 before. For the last 7 years, we haven't had it. We haven't needed it. It's not required. They're that optional. That being said, Emma has come in, who's one of my previous students, and been like, Dylan, we can do better. We can run PASS. We can make it useful to your students. Let's do this thing. So we're backing it here. And we're going to give it its first run this year. PASS will exist in many of your courses. Most of your courses will have been using it for longer than I have. So it might be a little bit clearer what its role in some of those other courses are. But particularly if, you're struggling with the course, you just want people to study with, any of that type of stuff, you can go to PASS and try it out. And if it's not for you, you don't have to keep going. It's fine. It's free. How do we join PASS classes? We'll talk about that in week one, but you can essentially just show up. I don't know if you can see them in your timetables yet, but you will be able to by Monday. You just show up to the pass class, physically go to the room, be there. We don't know how many people are going to show up in the first couple of weeks. You can sign up for them online so that we know that you're coming. But don't stress, basically, is the short answer. Okay, just popped up on Allocate Call. That must have been quite recent because as of a few days ago, I know it wasn't there. So it must have been a fairly new thing to get added. Pass is the thing that is labeled PA blah, blah, blah on the allocation new timetable. Correct. That is what passes. Sick. All right. Go away. Yeah. Anything else I can help you with? Oh, it's a 6:45. We pretty much nailed 2 hours in the end there. This was completely unplanned. This lecture just goes for as long as this lecture needs to go for. Are any past classes mandatory? No. No past class in any subject is ever mandatory. It is 100% optional. It's a good idea, particularly if you're struggling, but it's absolutely not mandatory. Same wavelength there, Liam. All right. I think we're good. I'm going to call it here. I'll hopefully see a bunch of you tomorrow. Otherwise, I will see all of you next week because I'm going to make it to every single one of your classes. Say hello. Shout out to me. Good luck with your first week of semester. I'll see you back here 5 o'clock next week. Thank you for being so engaged. I'll see you guys all later.